Welcome, dear friends. So myself, I'm Raghu, and this is my friend Vijay here. And we are going to give a small talk titled, Should You Know Category Theory? But yeah, there's a why part also there, just to tease you a bit. So yeah, without further ado, let me begin this talk. Yeah, I would just like to give a brief intro about both of us. Like Vijay and myself have been in what was known as service-oriented architecture. So we have been like, we progressed from being a normal C developer, C++, Java, and then on to like what was known as web services back then. And yeah, that's why we basically like to joke that we were doing a lot of plumbing. We're like plumbers between different disparate systems, different interfaces and all those things. So we have more than a decade of experience in like integrating complex systems both in Europe and US and Middle East and whatnot. So as part of our experience, we went on realizing that we are going too high level, like we are just doing the integration job. But personally, we both were very fond of programming and getting our hands dirty in code and like math and patterns, and we are like patternophiles, I like to joke to Vijay, that we like to find patterns in mathematics, in numbers, and in day-to-day life, even in biology, chemistry, everything. So in fact, I was just thinking, I was just discussing with Vijay that I saw a small snippet of a fact, like, yeah, it might sound a bit gross, but just now all of you had lunch, and maybe you enjoyed and all those things. So there are tiny taste buds on our tongue, and they require that the molecules of the food be transformed to a particular form to work. So without our saliva, again it's doing a transformation and a mapping. It's more like an adapter kind of a pattern. Yeah, so yeah, this integration related stuff led us from one thing to another, but then we were itching to get our hands dirty with code. And so, from the past 5 to 6 years, we have been working with startups in India, where we get a lot of chance to, you know, get our hands dirty and really see the code upfront and, you know, be able to guide juniors as well as learn some of the nice design patterns and things like that. So that's where we are. And slowly, as a progression of our search or our quest for the ideal way of programming things or doing things, it led from one thing to another, like object-oriented, and then Lisp, and then somehow we ended up with Haskell and category theory, Mathematica, and things like that. So yeah, that's just briefly about us. Like, just consider us as one amongst yourselves, like fellow travelers on this journey of learning what's the best way to do things. Yeah. So yeah, I believe I have spoken on behalf of Vijay as well, and we have been colleagues for more than 8 to 10 years right now. So we have joined startups together, and we have even quit a startup recently to completely dive into FP and category theory and machine learning and things like that for almost a year. So lots of interesting things happen. Yeah, so that's briefly about us. I don't want to talk too much about us right now. Yeah, so let me set the agenda right now in the beginning. So for those of you who are expecting that this is going to be a detailed category theory tutorial, I'm really sorry. I'm really sorry to disappoint you guys. But yeah, so I would like to just state it up front that this is not going to be yet another category theory tutorial, because we strongly believe that there are much more deserving people out there on the internet or in terms of books or whatever to teach what all this category theory entails. It's like a huge, huge subject, actually. It's just like an extension of what we call as an algebra. So algebra itself is like a huge kind of an abstraction over arithmetic. So there are lots of resources out there, and I'm pretty sure that most of you are already onto that road right now. So what this talk is not about is that it's not about what all is there in this category theory, like what all are the concepts. But what we would like to talk about, however, is first of all, like, how did we end up here? Like, what, how did this category theory somehow, you know, insinuate itself into this stream of what we call as programming? Like, most of the programmers will be like irritated, like, what is this high-fi sounding category theory terms that are being bandied about left and right. So we would just like to give a small brief overview of how it came to be in this state right now that almost everybody left, right and center are talking about like category theory concepts. So that's something that we would like to give, because that perspective will help you to kind of appreciate why category theory is kind of important, and it's going to be important even down the line. And then we would like to give a very brief overview into CT, just like dipping our toes into the waters of category theory, just the basic concepts that we think are important, and especially in the world of functional programming, or what we can term it as compositional style of programming. And yeah, and then of course most of you would have come here with some expectation that what's in it for me, what's in it for me, like this talk maybe I'll give some kind of an overview of category theory and the history, blah blah blah, but are there any insights that I can take from this talk so that tomorrow when I am faced with some kind of an integration problem or some kind of a problem, maybe it will strike in my mind that there could be some beautiful pattern at work here, so that you can apply something and get some bang for your buck, like, yeah. So that's going to be the agenda of this talk, yeah. So yeah, basically one more thing I would like to say is like we would be glossing over the first part of this, like mainly we want to focus on what's in it for you, rather than, you know, dwell too much on the category theory terms and jargon, which will be too esoteric for most of you, because I believe that there are lots of you know, newbies also out here, not just experienced Haskellers or experienced category theory amateur mathematicians or whatever, budding mathematicians. So we would like to kind of gloss over this first part a bit fast, so that we can give proper you know, coverage of a sample case study where we'll show you like what category theory provides us. So let us begin, like how did we end up here? So actually what we will have to say is like math is everywhere, believe it or not, or like whether you would like to agree or not, like it's a bit of a philosophical thing as well, but mathematics is one of the underpinnings of reality right now, like at least the closest description to reality. And math is always full of abstractions, like math provides lots of abstractions, like a point or a line. A line is composed of a series of points, like how many points are there in a 1 centimeter line versus a 10 centimeter line, again it's like infinity, infinity, infinity is again like an abstraction. What is an infinity for an electron might not be an infinity for an elephant. So even a 1 centimeter line can become seemingly like an infinity. Like math is full of abstractions. And what is an abstraction? Abstractions are like tools that we humans have ourselves devised to make it easy to grapple with the complexity of this nature and to kind of communicate about those things. And the funny part is, even programming and computer science is chock full of abstractions, left, right and center. Like you see that there is a type code as an integer, but is it like a proper mathematical integer? Again, you have abstracted the mathematical concept of an integer and kind of cut some corners, because there are some hardware limitations on how much an integer can be, okay? So again, what you call as an integer is an abstraction. And in terms of programming, sometimes in games, say you're doing a game development or whatever, you will program in terms of abstractions called as an explosion, a weapon. See, they are not like real weapons, but you have created some kind of an abstraction. Like instead of saying Raghu and Vijay, we will say person of name X. So that becomes an abstraction, like we have abstracted away some details. So programming and computer science also deals with lots of abstractions. So it is kind of natural that whatever branch of mathematics deals with lots of abstractions is going to be a great fit with computer science and programming. And that is exactly what category theory is. So category theory is like a very, you know, it's been called as the mathematics of mathematics, like it's like a meta kind of mathematics. So because it is so abstract, yeah, it can be applied almost to a very boring extent that, you know, you can say like everything is category theory. One more aspect of math, at least the kind of math that programming people want to use, is like math is pure. in the sense, like take for example, like sin x or cos x, like the function does not do anything to the text. There is no, you know, side effects, what we call as side effects happening in that. Like every time I call sin 0, I will get the same value today, tomorrow, whatever. But that's not the case with say a DB call, like get the time, get the current time, or get me a random value. Again, things keep changing. So there are lots of complexities in trying to model the real world, but math is something that is pure, and that's why like functional programming especially was initially based on the idea of, you know, these pure functions, the so-called pure functions from set theory, where there is no side effects. And because there are no side effects, you automatically get what is called as referential transparency. Like I can always substitute an equivalent expression wherever that is being referenced. And that if you translate into programming, it gives you a lot of, you know, surety about the code. Because we can't afford to be very lax in programming, because right now programming is, you know, maybe powering like nuclear weapons or like, see, I work at a startup which does medicine delivery. So if you kind of goof up somewhere, like the effects can be disastrous. So that's why like FP provided a very strong foundation. And yeah, so to say that from where did this category theory come, we would like to have to kind of go back to the evolution of FP itself. Like it all started with lambda calculus, and I'm sure like most of you will be knowing this history again and again. I would not like to go into too much of details, but I think so it's my duty to kind of again pay respect to those pioneers who made this possible. So lambda calculus, this came in 1930, and in fact Haskell is kind of based on lambda calculus and most of the functional programming languages that we have. And then somewhere down the line, this is not directly related to FP as such, but in the 1950s, so Saunders, MacLean and Eilenberg, so these people were studying like algebras, and they came up with something called as a category, and you know, natural transformations between categories and things like that. So just keep that in mind, because it's going to come back pretty soon now. And then in 1958, this was the first version of Lisp, thanks to John McCarthy and his students. So they wanted to kind of implement the lambda calculus, you know, because they believed that lambda calculus is a very powerful tool, a very expressive tool going forward in the field of artificial intelligence or like fact-based systems and all those things. And then once Lisp came, it became so popular, it caught on so much, that lots of different dialects of Lisp sprung up. And not just dialects of Lisp, but many people began to attempt different variants of functional programming languages. There was like ISWIM by Peter Landin, and David Turner implemented many pure functional programming languages. So there were lots of FP languages. And also the Turing lecture, has anybody gone through this paper, like Can Programming Be Liberated from the Von Neumann Style by John Backus. So there also he kind of proposed a pure functional programming language. And one more landmark paper, like which is a very small paper, but we strongly recommend that all newbies in functional programming go through this, because it really shows what can be achieved if you just have like simple functions, and especially if you can kind of abstract away the specifics, like and have the generic thing being done by a higher order function and all those things. So that was one more landmark paper. And yeah, so as I said, like there were many FP languages. So I have developed a language, my friend here who has come to a conference has developed his own language, but now we can't communicate with each other, we don't speak a common language. So the community became like restless, like how can we kind of create a research vessel which can kind of hold all our cumulative ideas of what functional programming should be. So that's when a committee of researchers came together, and finally, yeah, our one of our favorite languages, Haskell, was born in 1990, version 1.0. But yeah, as a newborn baby is born, like there are lots of some teething problems as well. So initially Haskell was, they decided that we'll really stick to purity. We just want like pure functional programming language, like only one function takes inputs, it only depends on the inputs and it can't do anything with the inputs and it simply returns some value. But is it of any use? Because the world is powered by side effects. Like, see, the user might want to enter some n and get back the square of that n. So sometimes you might want to do a DB query, so that involves side effects. So initially Haskell got stuck at this layer, like how to model side effects. That was like a very tough problem that they faced, and the functional programming languages that came before Haskell had somehow gotten around this by, you know, giving some kind of a backdoor, like okay, we'll make it like mutability is allowed, then just for side effects and all, arms I'll give like mutability or whatever. But Haskell people like did not budge to this temptation. So they just stuck it, So they were just waiting, like, is there any solution from pure mathematics? Because we are trying to model things from pure mathematics. Like, how can I model a random function now? Because right now, if I call random, it returns me 3, for example. After 5 minutes, if I call random, it gives me 5. Like, what argument is that random function taking? Because pure function says that if I give the same argument again and again, it should give me the same value. Then they were looking for the solution, and this landmark paper really like broke that jinx. Like, it's called as Notions of Computations and Monads by Eugenio Moji, and there he showed like how even these so-called side effects, the side effects can be different kinds of things, like your program encounters an exception, like I'm running a very extensive computation and the hard disk crashes or whatever, like an unexpected situation, an exception or non-determinism. All these different kinds of effects can be modeled using a concept from the category theory, which was like almost like 50 years ago, called as monads. So he showed how monads can be used to kind of represent computational effects. So this was a landmark paper. And then, just having a landmark paper wouldn't cut it. Like, somehow, someone has to kind of do the work of bringing it into the language that was stuck without having this facility for side effects. So Philip Wadler and they came up with this concept of bringing in monads in Haskell. They even came up with the concept of type classes, which are a bit like interfaces in Java. So that's how like monads got incorporated into Haskell. And now we would like to give a small category theory intro. I hope it's okay that we just glossed through these details. Okay, so maybe you can see how category theory, it did not purposely come there. They were really stuck with a problem and they just happened to see that category theory solves that very elegantly. And then not just monads, people went on discovering more and more patterns. So in fact, if you see, there are lots of things right now from the category theoretic world, like lenses or whatever. Like, so that's how category theory came to the mainstream. Just like say in physics, we have string theory. Like someone saw like, just an equation for a string can describe some particles and processes and whatnot. So that's how string theory has come into mainstream physics. Similarly, category theory came into Haskell and other programming languages. So right now we will give a very brief intro, a very, very brief intro of what we think is the core concept of category theory. It's only like very simple. So category theory talks about objects and morphisms. In fact, some authors even say that it should be called as the mathematics of arrows. I think so. Stephen Avoddi, I think so. He jokingly says that. So category theory kind of studies objects and their relationships. So there are a bunch of objects, a set of objects, and then a bunch of morphisms. I don't want to use the word set. I'm sorry. But a bunch of objects, and then there could be a bunch of morphisms. morphism in the sense there might be a relationship between this object and this object, but how mathematicians view it as this object is morphing into this object. So it's like a transformation, and some people even call that as a mapping, a simple mapping. And one more requirement in category theory is that these morphisms should compose, and I believe most of you have kind of gone through this high level intro to category theory already. So and one more thing for a category is that the composition operator there, like that is like f dot g dot h, that should also satisfy three laws. These are called as the category laws also, like there is an associativity law, like it doesn't matter in what order I compose, I am kind of piping together or stringing together these morphisms. And also there should be a left identity as well as a right identity, like there should be some kind of a if I take an example of an addition, there should be a zero so that there is an identity element, like even if I add it to the zero, again I get the same object back. So these are the only basic requirements for you to form a category. Yeah. Correct. That's it. And don't worry, we would not go into too much of these details, because we will quickly go into what insights this can provide with only a very minimal amount of understanding. And some examples of a category. The set itself, what we call it as set, is also a kind of a category. It's called the category set, where the objects are themselves like sets and the morphisms are mappings. So there could be something like the set of natural numbers and then the set of perfect squares. So again, there is a mapping. There are lots of mappings. That mapping is nothing but that x squared is that mapping. So, and then there is also this popular category called as Hask, which you will encounter a lot in case you are kind of dealing with Haskell. And Hask is nothing but the objects are types, because sometimes, you know, a type can be viewed as a set of values, a set of allowed values. For example, a Boolean type is a set with only two values, like true and false. And then the morphisms here are the functions in Haskell. So that's why if you have a Haskell function, the type signature clearly says like it's like a mapping from int to int. And So I gave an example of a set, I gave an example of a Hask, okay, these are two categories. There is also a category called as cat, okay, just bear with me, where the objects themselves are categories. One level further, the objects themselves are categories and the morphisms there are what are called as functors. So a functor is a way of kind of, you know, mapping one category into another category. In fact, it has deep implications. So they even say that it can kind of represent like a transfer of knowledge from one field to another field, like if a field is considered like a category. So just bear with us. So a functor is nothing but a morphism, okay, where the objects themselves are categories. And in Haskell, it so happens that there is already a category Hask, okay, and you don't have any other category. So if you just replicate, if you just copy paste two Hasks, Hask categories, and kind of imagine a morphism, or it's like if you can allow me to say that it's a morphism back into Hask itself, some category, and it's a morphism back into that only. Like that's why it is called as an endofunctor. Sometimes you might have heard of the term endofunctor. It's nothing but an endomorphism, a morphism onto the same category. So yeah, this whole thing becomes one object, and such a category is called as the category cat. And then a functor is a morphism in such a category. And the main thing you should remember is like functors. And all other things are like, see, a monoid is also a functor, an applicative is also a functor, and I believe many people attended a talk just now about monads, applicatives, and functors, of course. So functors are the basic things in category theory, and we will shortly see like how functors can come into play if you just know these like basic laws, and if you can find some operation like that. So here there is just a dot operator, but there can be many other operators, like there can be a plus, there can be a Kleisli arrow. That's what we'll show now shortly. Okay, so this is what you need to kind of understand. So initially when we were studying category theory, we always tripped up in that part only, like what is this functor, like where the category categories are objects. So but the category actually is Hask. Those objects are like Hasks. And yeah, I think so, enough of me, and I think so, I'll just give way to Vijay, who will just give a small glimpse of category theory.
So hope yeah. Everybody is still awake.
Yeah.
Okay. So we just had lunch, so yeah. So I think he did a very good job at convincing you guys that, okay, math is important, at least that much, because at least it Haskell is the way it is today because of that math. So at least that is good enough reason to for us to believe that, hey, it's going to be important. Math is important. So, but okay, just so that I don't talk too much about jargons and other things in the category theory, how many of you have already tried to learn and or gone beyond the basics? How many of you tried and gone beyond the basic things? Okay, few hands.
Monads, okay. monads.
In the category theory, not in the typical, okay, a monad is a type class kind of way, but from the category, not many. So, okay. So I'll try not to go too deep into that. Okay. So what we are going to do here is, so that's what our agenda was, not to get too much into the depths of category theory, but try to give you an example application and see, and start from the solution space, right? If you're beginner in Haskell, and the way you learn about these things is they make you write some code and say, hey, see, now you can see this pattern repeating. Hey, this matches the functor program we wrote earlier. This is the same pattern, so we can make this. But that is not the way we usually write our application or conceptualize our application. We think, how do we model our application? So if you're in object-oriented world, you would think of your object model, or you would think of all the patterns that you would use. And then you think of, how do I write it in your particular language? The same way, we think of all the functions. If you're, you know, C or similar languages, your approach is different. But here, at least in the beginning stages, what we learn is we were taught to look for those patterns and then, okay, refactor your code to use a functors or a monad, because that is how we do. So what at least I will try to do is, given a solution, given a problem, can we model it using what we call category theory and then come to code? Can we identify these abstractions? As you said, abstractions are the core of programming. Then can we start from this abstraction? We say, hey, category theory is all about abstraction. Can we start with this abstraction and come down to Haskell? So that is what we are trying to explain here. We are exploring that here today. So what we are, this is the example that we are taking. So we're trying to model a tree growth. So I'll try to explain this problem. It's a tree, as in not a binary tree. It's a tree that we see everywhere, natural tree. And a tree grows every year. Right, year at duration, some duration of time, it keeps growing. As long as it is alive, it keeps growing. Like, there is a likelihood of being hit. So hit isn't as somebody cut it down, it fell, or there is a natural disaster. So that happens. A fallen tree doesn't grow. What do we need to do? After a certain number of years, we want to calculate, what is the probability of that tree being hit or fell, or right? We want to calculate that, right? So this is what we want to do, right? So we know that this is a probabilistic model. We want to calculate the probability of your tree being in a particular state after such and such time. So what we are trying to do now, right? How do we do it? At least we try to do some things. So I think from the problem statement itself, we can derive few things. So what are the possible states a tree can be, right? I think you can guess. It can be alive, it can be hit, it can be, right? One of the three states that it can be, right? And distribution, right? We know already, because we already realized that it's a probability distribution, so we have to somehow represent that distribution, right? So this is one way of representing that, right? An associated list, a state and the probability. Say, probability of it being alive is 0.3, right? And probability of it being fallen is so and so. So we can represent that. And there are things that can happen. So what do we want to do with these states? We have states and we have distribution. What can we do with it, right? A tree can grow, we hit and fall. This is what we can do. Year on year, this is what we do. These are the things that we already know from our generic problem domain, right? So what is this? What are we trying to do here? So every year, a state is transitions into a probability of that state after that year. What we want to achieve is, given a particular state, a tree in a particular state, what is the distribution of that, right? A state to its distribution. That is what we want to identify. Lost? Any questions?
It's
a set of states. There's nothing special about that notation.
One small example I would give is, like, in case you are doing a coin toss, then the distribution would be, assuming like it's an unbiased coin, it will be a list of two, like head 0.5, tail 0.5. And here, one more thing I would like to point out here is that this is more like a dependent kind of an event. Like, once it falls, again it cannot be alive or grow. So the output actually is required for the next stage here. Yeah.
So this, what he's trying to say is, yeah. So the after year one, so we say we start with a coin toss. We take a coin toss, the very popular example. So first, each coin toss is independent. So every time you toss, its probability is going to be 0.5. an unbiased coin, right? But if it is continuous, I mean, if you want to take a progression of that, so what is the probability of two successive heads or two successive tails? Then you have to feed in the result of first iteration into the second state, right? So you are transitioning one. So now you have to feed that into the next stage. The probability of being alive after year one, that is the input for the second year, whatever it is. So we want to chain that event that we are. So you can think of that already. So you know that, right? So this is what we will end up with. So we have a state and we want to get a distribution of it, and then we have to chain those things, state to distribution, right? So what do we see here, right? So I'm kind of giving you the same diagram which is there, right? He already given you the example of how the functor, so you can see this is again the same category. He gives you the example of functor. So FA, FB, FC are the functors. So we are in a category of functors. Why did I come here? Yes, so this is where the trick is, right? What are we trying here? So FA, so it's just the name, right, I gave. We want to start, coming back here, distribution. So what we are trying to do is, given a state, we want to somehow come up with that distribution, right? So if you consider a state, each state, now you want to somehow get into its distribution. So think of states as a category now, right? State is a category and distribution is another category, and we have to somehow take your states into distribution. Don't go there yet.
Correct.
Right? So what we want to achieve, the last point, you have, say, think of, so let's generalize it. So you have something, right? A set of things, right? States. So think of them as a category, right? It has objects, right? What we want to do is we want to morph them into another category, which is distribution, right? So you want something, a state, a distribution. For example, if I have a coin and a distribution of coin, so you want to take a, given a coin, what you want is a distribution. Say, normal distribution is different. Uniform distribution, say for coin toss, it is usually uniform distribution, 0.5, 0.5, right? So, or you can have your own distribution, whatever distribution is. It need not be uniform all the time. So what you want to get is, given a particular set of things, you want to get a distribution of it, right? So that is the transformation that we are doing. So if you think of this as two different category of objects, right? Distribution is a category of object. Your state is a category of objects. What you want to achieve is somehow getting from states to distribution. Now, if you're still not lost, this is what we learned in functors, from one category into another category, right? That is what we want to do here. So at this point, you're already thinking, oh, my distribution is a functor. I don't know how we are going to represent distribution, but I already know. If you model these things as categories, you already know my distribution is a functor because I want to take it from here to here. We don't know anything else, but we know. That is the beauty of category theory. We don't go into the depths of what the inside each object. We don't know the structure of a relationship between whatever is the objects. We are just looking at objects, their morphisms, and there are certain laws. So that is where we want to stay. We don't know how distribution is represented. We don't know how state is. This is just to explain you. So we don't know anything particular, but we know distribution is definitely going to be a functor, right? So we already know that. Now, he mentioned one more thing, right? That we want to chain those things. So we have, we will not, so you know, he talked about composition. How many of you already know what composition is? Composition. Almost everyone,
yeah.
Good.
Yeah.
So what does composition do? Given two functions, we compose them, right? So what does it mean to compose now? So what we already know that we have this events, right? Which is some state to some distribution, and we want to apply it again and again. So 1 year we got a distribution, and then the second year, it's the same thing, right? The distribution after 2 years is the distribution, whatever is the value of your, so if you're looking for whether it is alive, probability of the tree being alive, so whatever is this probability after year one, do the same thing again for year two, right? So we are composing again, same thing, you're composing. You're trying to compose what we have already, right? So we know how to transform your state into your distribution. We want to do it again. So you're composing them, right? So coming back to your category theory, right? All we know is composition. So initially what we had, so I'll just give you a simple look at ID and return yield. So look at the dot or composition, the signature of B to C, A to B, A to C, right? Composition, and you know that part. Look at the second thing. It looks same, but it is MC. I don't want to use the M word, right? So it's a good time to do that, maybe. He talked about being endo functor, being So what we are trying to compose something, and we are composing a same thing, right? This example here, B to MC, A to MB, A and B are different, we are trying to compose. But in our case, it's the same thing. We are trying to compose the same thing. We don't have two different things. We have to compose two distribution or transitions, as we called them. So we want to compose the same thing. What is that concept which allows you to compose similar things? It's a monoid, right? So like addition, the triplet addition. So you monoid, you compose the same thing. So we come up with that strange. So there are some terms that we already know. Something is a monoid in endofunctor, right? This famous code, right? So we satisfied all the thing. So we know it's a monoid, whatever we have. So we want, so this is clear. Now we want to make our distribution, whatever we call, a monoid, because we want to compose them. It was already a functor. We want to use it as a monoid now. We want to compose them. It's already a monoid. And we know in Has, everything is an endofunctor. So something is a monoid in the category of endofunctor. That is M or monad. Monad is a monoid in the category of endofunctor, the very infamous thing. So we got there. So we already know that my distribution is a monad. I don't know anything about its internal details. I already know it's going to be a functor, it's going to be a monoid, and it's a monad, right? So once I know this, how do you, so now you look at this B to the arrow, right? The equation below the composition, that's called the Claisley arrow, because we are in the Claisley category. So this is the, so where you're composing those functors, right? We are composing monoids in the functor. So look at this type signature for this fish or left fish, as popularly known, right? B to MC, A to MB, right? So MC and MB are our functors, but in our case, because we are dealing with distribution, so it would be A to distribution of A, and again, A to distribution of A, because we want to apply the same thing again, right? Our transformation applied again, and we get A to distribution of C. So what we want to use is this Claisley arrow in our program. So we are composing such things, right? So we know. So now it's all about, so now we know, we have already modeled your program using, okay, now already I know what my, it's only the internal details, how you represent distribution. I think we got a simple model where we express distribution as a associated list, right? A comma probability. So, and one more thing about this solution, what we came up with. So we started off with solving a specific problem of tree growth. We were supposed to solve tree growth. It was only supposed to work for tree structure, but we never mentioned tree anywhere. We came up with a very generic solution that works with anything where you want distribution, probability distribution. So replace A here, right? Distribution of A, right? So you know all the parametricity, parametric types. So replace A with tree, yeah. Replace A with coin, you got distribution of coins. So you got a very generic solution even without putting any effort at making it generic. That is the beauty of category theory. You are working at a level where you're not at all dealing with the specifics of your problem, but you get a generic solution, you know, because the way category theory is defined, right? We are still with the very basics, but we achieved this even without any effort. All you want to do is put the specifics, right? So that's what we are talking about here. The distribution type is mod. Okay, now we want to put an event as dice, okay? What are the possible states of a dice? Okay, 1 to 6. You want to do a coin toss, or you want to do a Monty Hall problem. Same solution. There is nothing different. You just, how do you use it? So you solve that problem without even, so you know what it is, how it looks like. Now you go change your, fit in your internal details. Probably coming from the yesterday's talk, probably whole-driven development, do whatever what's best for you, right? Fill in the dots, right? This example, even though in a different way, this example that I took is available in this functional pool, right? But even though they don't start with the way we described, they give you the total solution of how to do it. We just approach that from a different angle. We started from the category theory and came to the solution. They follow a slightly different approach, right? So you can go read it. You get. I think we are running out of time.
You can continue.
This one.
The main problem there is like the problem with all these so-called like papers or like academic papers or functional pearls, sometimes like at least functional pearls are a bit clear, but most of these academic papers, a newcomer won't understand, like won't get a feel for how they arrived at the result. What they simply say is that we have modeled the probability distribution as a monad, and that gives us great powers. But why? Like why or how did you get that intuition to model the probability distribution as a monad? So that was what our quest has been like, and it will continue to be. And just to conclude, like of course, like to reiterate the same thing, mathematics provides lots of abstractions, and abstractions are really powerful tools to deal with complexity. Like we say, like there is something plus something is something, like kind of try to like push the details, postpone the details, and then try to deal with things. And then of course design patterns, algorithms, data structures, like just because you know that a list is kind of ordered in a way, then you are able to apply binary search, a very powerful algorithm, for free. If you just kind of come into that abstraction and then you know the certain properties that are applicable, if that abstraction is satisfied, then you get lots of things for free. And why shouldn't we make use of this? That is our main thing. And of course, there is a kind of synergy needed between, you know, just bare theory and practice. Like if people go on doing like esoteric terms and esoteric research in terms of category theory and writing big tomes, and nobody kind of explains to the layman, like there are lots of popular authors, like Gabriel Gonzalez has lots of interesting articles. In fact, in 2016, if I am not mistaken, he has written a blog where he considers the electoral distribution of voters distribution in a constituency as a monad or a monoid. So in fact, yeah, but this functional pearl predates that by a much longer time. So there's a kind of synergy needed between like the so-called researchers and mathematicians and the so-called engineers. So the engineers also have to kind of put some effort to try and appreciate what is the beautiful things of mathematics or like basic research. Okay, yeah, sure. Yeah, sure, I'm just wrapping up. This is the last slide actually. And then I would like to stop it at this slide. So yeah, for those of you who think like why should I learn category theory, but yeah, my answer is like we do not know what we do not know. So you will not know the joy of knowing. Yeah, that's it. Yeah, thank you.